Good morning, everyone. Thank you for attending this Wednesday webinar. My name is Francisco de la Vega. I am CTO of FiCodes, which is the company in the fiber ecosystem, who is taking care of the data publication and data monetization components. The topic for today's webinar is monetizing your organization data. We are going to focus on context data offered by a context broker. And well, the learning goals that we have for today are these ones. We are going to start with having a look at what is the business API ecosystem generic enabler from Fiber, how this business API ecosystem generic enabler is related with the Fiber security framework components, and how you can use both the business API ecosystem and Fiber security framework components in order to monetize the access to context data. And finally, we will finish reviewing a little bit how the business API ecosystem software can be extended in order to fit on those environments that are not following exactly the same kind of deployment or exactly the same kind of data access that we are using in our deployments. First of all, which is the business API ecosystem? The business API ecosystem is a generic enabler from the Fiber infrastructure, which is intended to create any kind of marketplace. So it supports the definition of offerings around any kind of digital asset, and it takes care of the offering lifecycle since the creation of the offerings till the billing, the charging, the usage management, and all these business related aspects. It is fully integrated with the Fiber identity management and in general, the Fiber security framework. And it relies on standard TM forum APIs. So the business ecosystem is exposing its whole functionality through a REST API defined by the TM forum in their standards. Well, as I said, the business API ecosystem supports the monetization of any kind of digital asset. The idea is that all the functionality which is related with particular assets, when we're talking about assets, we are talking about a query to the context broker, but we are also talking about API service, or we are talking about even an Android application on any kind of asset. And all this stuff that is related with the asset itself is not part of the core of the business API ecosystem. The core of the business API ecosystem is providing the common functionality. So it is providing offering management, is providing product management, is providing charging, billing, usage management. And all the stuff that is particular to an asset is managed in what we are calling a business ecosystem extension or business ecosystem plugins. Each plugin is supporting the management of a specific digital asset type. For example, we have a digital asset type for NGSI ID queries. We have an asset for files and these kind of things. And these extensions are performing the validation of the product, is performing the validation of the permissions of the user to offer that product, is performing also the activation. It's not the same activating a query to a context broker than activating a query to a custom service. So all that stuff is handled in these extensions. The business ecosystem is supporting multiple price models. You can create open or free offers if you want. There is a difference between open and free. Free offerings are offers that do not have, you don't have to pay for them, but you have to buy them. So you need to go to the acquisition process. While open offers are offers that can be directly accessed without the need of acquiring them. For paid offers, we are supporting three basic price models. We are supporting one-time payments, which is the typical you pay and you get the offer. We are supporting subscriptions or recurring payments. So for example, monthly payment, yearly payment, and these kind of things. And we are also supporting pay-per-use. These basic models can be enriched, creating advanced models. It is possible to add another price component, for example, you can create a pay-per-use model and add an initial fee. So you pay an initial fee when you buy the offer, and then the rest of the payments are made based on your usage. Or you can create dynamic pricing. For example, you can create a discount, a 2% discount on on a pay-per-use model when you made more than a number of calls or this kind of dynamic pricing. The business API ecosystem is also in charge of the management of the different terms and conditions that apply to the offer. When you are creating an offering, you can define the terms and conditions, and then those terms and conditions need to be accepted by the different customers buying the different offers. There are different ways of creating the terms and conditions. There are a couple of built-in licenses in case the offer you are creating is data. So there are some data specific licenses, but there is also the possibility of creating custom licenses using the wizard or just providing the text for the terms and conditions. And we are also supporting the definition of service level agreements with different kinds of metrics we are going to see later. And the final feature from the business API ecosystem is the support for the revenue sharing. You can create revenue sharing models where you establish how the incomes generated by a particular offering need to be distributed among different stakeholders. This is useful in case you create an offer with multiple providers involved. And well, in general, you can create revenue sharing models establishing the percentage that each stakeholder involved in the offer should receive, and you can bound them to the offerings. So when the incomes from a particular offering are received by the business API ecosystem, component is going to apply that revenue sharing model and is going to calculate how many money should go to each of the involved stakeholders for the particular offering. Okay, this is the main concept regarding the business API ecosystem. As I said, the business API ecosystem is intended to monetize any kind of asset. But how are we monetizing data within Fiverr? This is a typical Fiverr architecture. You may have seen it a couple of times. And for data monetization, these are the components we are using right now. The asset that we are going to monetize is a couple of entities within the Orion Context Broker. In general, what we are going to offer is the access permissions to a set of entities within the Orion Context Broker. This access is going to be managed by the Fiverr security framework. So we need the identity manager in order to manage the users and the roles of that users. In this scenario that we are following today, I'm going to use Keyrock, but the business ecosystem is also integrated with Keyclock in case that fits better your needs. And then the access to the context broker is managed by the PEP and the PDP for access permissions. And in the scenario we are following today, we are using a software which is implementing both, which is called API Umbrella. But again, if in your scenario you feel better using Wilma and Outsita Force or the policy decision point integrated within Keyrock, this is also a possibility. I'm not going to extend so much in the concepts around the securitization of Fiverr architectures because there is already a very nice webinar published in YouTube. So if you want to have a deeper look on how you can secure the different APIs within Fiverr, you can read that webinar, you can see that webinar, and have all the points you need. Okay, so we have these components for data monetization and how we are monetizing the things. The first step in the data monetization scenario we are following today is securing the access to the context broker. So we have a context broker, and we need to create a couple of access policies. That access policy should establish what HTTP method, what tenant, what entities, under what circumstances the user can users are going to be able to access to the context broker. And then we need to create a role in the identity manager who maps to that access policy. So you can see that we are using a role-based access control mechanism here. And this is quite relevant because at the end of the day, what we are doing when we are authorizing a user is granting the role that we have created mapped to that policy to the different users. So the first step is securing the access to the context broker, and then we are able to create an offering. Creating an offering is not more than creating the offer in the business API ecosystem. We need to choose the extension for this particular asset type, which as we are going to see later is called NGSILD query. And we are going to provide a couple of information. We are going to provide the query information, and we are also going to provide the role that has been created in the identity management. So the extension of the business API ecosystem is going to validate that the user creating the offer is authorized to create that offer, is going to validate that the role that we have provided is valid within the application that we are monetizing, and is going to validate that there is a valid access policy taking into account the query that we have provided. So as this is a lot of information from one moment, what I'm going to do is doing it live. So I have prepared some stuff, Chris Pullman. We have this query to the context broker. You can see that we are making a query to, in this case, it's an Orion LD instance, but it could be any of the context brokers that we have in the system. And we are going to try to retrieve entities of type streetlight from a firewall service, which is called webinar. And at this stage, we should be able to make this request because this is not secure. Okay, the context broker is fully open right now. So the first step we need to do is securing the access to this context broker. For that, I'm going to use the default firewall security framework. The first thing I'm going to do is accessing to Keyrock instance with an administrator user. And now I am going to look for the application that I have registered for the context broker instance. Within our case is this one called API access. And now I'm going to create a role that is going to be bounded to the access policies that we are going to use later. So I go to the manage role section and I'm going to create a new role. In this case, it can be called webinar.lights, for example. And I'm going to add the role and I'm going to save this. As I said, the component that I am using in order to secure this one is a component which is called API Umbrella, who has a graphical interface and which managing everything within the API Umbrella component. So I don't need to do anything else in the Keyrock stuff. I can go directly to API Umbrella. I am using this API Umbrella, who has a graphical interface, and it has another advantage from my point of view, which is that it can be used in order to secure multiple APIs. So as you can see in this instance, we are securing our whole firewall infrastructure with a single API Umbrella instance. So as the stuff that we want to secure is the access to the context broker, the API I need to use is the Orion Context Broker API. How you are securing a Orion Context Broker using API Umbrella? Well, what you are doing with API Umbrella is creating a mapping with the information that is then sent in the request. API Umbrella knows with the information of the request, which is the backend service it needs to access and it does. So in this case, you need to register the server. In this case, this is the internal URL from the Orion Context Broker. And then you provide the mapping. In this particular scenario, we are using host names in order to know which API we need to access. So all the host names are pointing to the same API Umbrella instance, and all the host and all the requests directed to the context.oplify.eu host name are going to be matched with this API. There are other options. It is also possible to have a single host name and then separate the different APIs using prefixes. For example, you can set /context/ or whatever you want to do. And now we want to configure the context broker. Very important thing is this allow external authorization point. This is how we are mapping this register API with an Keyrock application. So this IDP app ID is the application ID of the application who has the users and the roles. You can see this is this one. The same that we are using in order to secure the context broker is mapped here. And then well, you have some stuff, you can create rate limits and so on, but the access policies are created as sub URL request settings. So what I'm going to do is create a new sub URL request setting, which is a sub match that is done once the request has matched with this particular API, and it's going to provide some extra data. I'm going to copy this URL because it's going to be easier. And I'm going to create a sub URL. So for the sub URL, you have a couple of things that can be configured. You can configure the HTTP method. In this case, we are only going to allow GET requests. I'm going to allow to query all the to use the query endpoints for the context broker, and I'm going to limit this to the to this tenant. As you can see, this is the one we are using. So I'm creating a simple policy that establishes GET requests to the query endpoint within the webinar firewall service. Okay, then you can configure a couple of things, and now the important one is that in order to make this GET request to the query endpoint within the webinar tenant, it is needed to have the webinar.lights role that we have created previously. An important thing is checking override required roles from global request settings, because in a production environment, typically you are going to provide a strict role securing the whole API, for example, an administration role, and then the less restrictive access is created in sub URL settings. If you don't click the override required roles from global request settings, what is going to happen is that this is become as an ANT. So if you have an administrator role securing the whole API, users, even if they have this role, are not going to be authorized to access here. And then finally, you can also override. You can provide specific write limits for this tenant. Okay, so I'm creating this. I'm saving this. And finally, I need to publish the changes in order to make them live. So if I go back here, I shouldn't be able to make a request without providing an access token. But if I try to make a request also with an authenticated token, in this case, I'm accessing the token endpoint from Keyrock with a grant type of type password, I'm getting an access token for the context broker. And if I try to make an authorization request, it is also not authorized, because we have secured this in two ways. We have enabled the authentication, so it is needed to provide an access token, and we have also provided authorization. Users to make this request need to have the webinar.lights role. So if I go to the identity manager and I authorize customer 3 user, I can grant him the webinar.lights role. I can save this. And now, if I get a new valid access token, the user is authorized to access to the data. Why is this relevant? Because as we are going to see now, the business ecosystem is going to make exactly the same process I have done manually with the accounts portal in order to authorize the customers of the different offer. So now that we have secured the access to the context broker, it's time to go to the marketplace, and it's time to create an offer with all this information that we have here. So in order to do that, I can go to the marketplace. This is the business API ecosystem software that we have in place. This is a global instance of the marketplace, and I'm going to log in with a user with a seller role or permissions to create an offer. You can see that once we are here, we have this main page intended to search for the different offers available in the marketplace. There are a couple of ways and a couple of options in order to filter the different offerings available. It is supporting a tagging or categorizing stuff that you can choose, filtering by opacity, by street lighting. You can also search by keyword, or you can search by catalog. The main difference between the categories and the catalogs is that the categories are defined by the system administrator. So the providers, the only thing that they can do is choosing the different categories when they are creating the offering, while the catalogs are created by the providers. So if you are a provider, you can create your own catalogs in order to filter the different offerings you are publishing, okay? So now what we are going to do is access to the seller specific section where we can manage three different kinds of objects. We have the catalogs, as I have said, we have the product specifications, and we have the offerings. In order to monetize any kind of asset within the system, you need to create a product specification and you need to create an offering. The product specification is the representation of the asset itself. So it has just asset specific information. The product spec has the endpoint, has the metadata, has the characteristics, has the attachment and these kind of things, while the offering is only dealing with the business related information. So it has the price model, it has the terms and conditions, it has the SLAs, and it has the revenue sharing model. Another important thing is that you can have a product spec and the same product spec can be offered in multiple offerings. So there is not the limitation of one-to-one in this scenario. So let's create a new product specification. We need to provide a name from the product, which in this case, it can be webinar data. The source is the brand. This is not mandatory, but in case you have a brand for your product different from the user who is creating the things, you can provide it here. And you can also provide an ID external, which this is for information purposes only. And the idea with this one is that if the product you are creating has an specific identifier within your system, you can put that identifier here so you can bind the product you are creating with the ID of the product in your internal systems. But this is not mandatory. You can also provide a description if you want. When creating a product specification, it is also possible to create bundles. So if you want to monetize a couple of things in a single product, so multiple products are acquired in a single acquisition, you can do it by creating bundles. I'm not going to do that. And then we go to the asset section. This is the most important section within the product spec. This digital asset type is what I have been talking about the digital asset extensions. Each extension installed in the system appears here as an asset type in this select. You can see that we have a couple of extensions installed for monetizing different kinds of things. We have, by default, all the business API ecosystem component comes with a basic service that is just providing a URL and just providing the media type for the URL, only URL. It comes with a basic file that allows you to create offers that are just a file that is uploaded. So when users buy the stuff, they are able to download whatever file you have included here. And then we have the complex extension that we have included for data monetization. In this case, I'm going to use NGSILD query. And you can see that this has a couple of more information here. The first thing I need to provide is the URL of the asset. This is the URL of the context broker, which is context.oplafy.eu. Then webinar. And I'm going to copy paste this. Then you have to provide the media type, which in this particular case is a select, and the only option is application LDJSON because it's the only one currently supported by this extension. And then we have to provide more data. We need to provide which are the entities we are going to monetize, which in this case is a streetlight. We need to provide which is the NGSILD tenant that is going to be offered, which is this one, webinar. And finally, we need to provide which is the acquisition role that is going to be used by the business API ecosystem in order to grant access to the different services, which, as we have seen, is webinar.lights. Okay, so now we can go on. We have already provided the asset information, and now we need to provide characteristics information if we want. This is just for information purposes. If you are creating a product and you want to provide a couple of new characteristics, you can create values for the different characteristics so the users can review the data when they are buying, but this is not mandatory. Then we have an attachment section. There are two kinds of attachments. We have the one important, which is the logo. It can be providing a URL pointing to the logo, or it can be uploaded from your computer. In this case, I have this logo for the offer. You'll see that it is uploaded. And then you have the options to provide extra attachments. The extra attachment is intended, for example, to provide documentation. If you are offering a service and you want to provide a PDF document with the documentation of your service, this is something that can be provided as an attachment. Or if you are offering data and you want to attach the data model of the data you are offering, this is another thing that can be uploaded as an attachment. And the final thing that you can provide for a product are relationships. Relationships are intended for managing the life cycle of the products within your organization. With relationships, you can create migration of substitutions in case you are deprecating something, for example, and you want to create a new product that is going to replace an existing one, or you can also create dependencies and exclusivities in case you want to create that kind of relationship between products. I'm not going to create nothing, and I can go directly to finish, where we can review all the information that we have provided and we can create a product. So once we have the product, this has been created in active state, which means that this is not yet being monetized. So we can still review the characteristics. You can see that the metadata that we have provided for the asset has been transformed into characteristics. So we have the type, we have the firewall service, we have the location, the media type. You can update attachments or you can create new relationships. I'm not going to do anything of that. It is also possible to upgrade your products. If you are offering some kind of software and you have new versions and you don't want to create a new product spec that is a replacement, you can just upgrade the one that you have here, providing the new version and providing the new asset, as you can see here. But I'm not going to do anything, so I'm going to move the status to launch it, which means this product is ready to be monetized. So I'm upgrading this. And now our product is here. And now I have my asset represented in the system. The next step is creating an offering for that asset. So I am able to go to the offerings and create a new offer. Again, I need to provide all the business information that relate to this. I'm going to call it exactly in the same way. For example, webinar data. You can provide a description if you want. It is allowing you to provide places in case your offer is only available in a certain location. You can set the different locations here. You can create also bundles of offerings. There is a difference between the bundle of offerings and the bundle of products. The bundle of offerings is intended in those scenarios where you want to provide a different price model when the user are buying a couple of offers together. For example, you may have three offers with three softwares. Each of them may have a price model of €1. So if you buy the three of them, you are going to pay €3. But you can create a bundle adding the three offers and provide a price model of €2. So if you buy the three of them, you have a better pricing than if you buy just them by separately. Well, we have to choose which is the product specification we are going to offer. Within our case, is this webinar data. We have to choose in what catalog we are going to publish the offering, for example, in this webinar data. Here is where you are going to categorize your offer so it can be filtered in the homepage. In our case, we are offering real-time data of the smart city environment because they are streetlights. Then we have to provide the terms and conditions. As I said before, there are three options. If you are offering data, you can just choose one of the valid open data licenses, or you can create a custom terms and conditions. You can choose the wizard. So there are a couple of clauses that you can select, or if any of this is valid for you, then you can create a custom license just with the title and the text. In this case, for example, I'm going to choose a standard open data license. You can provide metrics for SLA, so you can choose the update rate, the response times, or the delay, and provide the different metrics to be satisfied or that are satisfied by the service you are offering. And well, we come to the important place, which is creating new price plans. We can create one-time, recurring, or pay-per-use models. For example, I'm going to create, a one-time payment, for example, and I'm going to add a price of €5. You can provide a description for the price plan, and this is just a payment. If we want, we can. If we want, we can update this a little bit with price alterations. You can add a new price component. You can add a discount, for example, or a fee, or these kind of things, in case you want to create something a little bit more complex. And the last step is choosing the revenue sharing model. I have the default revenue model that comes with a system, with basically it stating that the 100% of the incomes of my offering are going to go to the provider, in this case is me. I have also another revenue sharing model, which is stating that 80% of the percentage is going to go to me, and a 20% of the percentage is going to go to other stakeholders. The revenue sharing models can be created in the interface here in this section. We can review it later if we have time. And well, I'm choosing the default revenue model, and now I can create the offer. Okay, again, this is created in active status. You can review the agreements, you can create new price plans, or you can change the categories if you want. I don't want to do anything of that, so I'm going to launch my offer. And now my offer is here. Now we have created an offering that can be acquired by third-party users. So let me go back to this slide. We are at this point right now. So now that we have an offer acquired in the system, an offer published in the system, if a user wants to access to the data we have published, what the user needs to do is acquiring the offering. So he can access to the business API ecosystem and software and acquiring the offering, and the extension that we have, the one that we have chosen, the NGS ILD query one, is going to update the user permissions in the context locker application. So the user is going to have the webinar.lights role that we have state as metadata of the offer that we have created. Once the permission has been updated, the user is able to access to the data. So the user can make a request with a valid access token. That access token is going to be validated with the identity manager in order to authenticate the user. With this authentication, we are going to get the authentication OK and the user information, in this case, the roles the user has in the application. With that, with the request the user has made and the user info and the roles the user has, we are able to check if the user is authorized to make the request. So in this case, we are going to check the different policies that we have. In our particular scenario where we are using API Umbrella, is basically checking if we have a URL setting that match the request. We are going to have a look at what roles are required to make the request for that sub URL. And if the user has that particular role, we are going to return an OK. So the user, the request is redirected to the context broker. The request is locked in the database. In our case, it's an Elasticsearch, in order to be able to fit the pay-per-use models. So all the requests that we are making are locked there, and in order to fit that usage models. And then we have the data response to the user. So if we want to see this in action, I'm going to go back to Postman, and I'm going to try to make a request with a different user. In this case, for example, could be for customer 5. I get a valid access token for customer 5, and I'm going to try to access to the context broker. I need to say that I am not authorized to make this request, but I am able to sign in into the marketplace. I'm going to sign in with a customer 5 user. Okay, so I can sign in. You can see that this user is not a provider, so there are less options valid here. And I'm going to look for something that fits my needs. In this case, we have this webinar data offering. We can review the offer. Here we have the tags. Here we have the description. Here we have the initial price model. We can see the information of the data. We can review the characteristics. So we can see that this is an NGS ILD query. This is the location, and this is the firewall tenant. And here we can see the different agreements. We have the license and we have the price plan. Okay, everything looks good to me. So I'm going to add it to the cart. We have a final review of the options that we are, of the offer that we are going to buy. So here we have again the characteristics. You can see that I cannot click on the add to the cart because it's disabled. because I need to go to the terms and conditions and I need to accept the terms and conditions explicitly before buying this, and I can also review the different price plans. In this case, we only have one, but it is possible to create multiple price plans for the offer. So if you create multiple price plans, the user, when buying the offer, can choose the one that best fits their needs. For example, you can create a recurring model with a monthly payment and a pay-per-use model. So users that are going to make a lot of calls probably are going to prefer the monthly payment, and users that are going to use less the service, maybe they prefer to use the pay-per-use model. This is something that can be done. So we add it to the cart and we can check out. So we have a summary. This is the offer we are buying. We are going to pay €5. We can provide additional comments. This is something that is a note. If you write something here, the provider of this is going to receive that note and they can even answer you. And then you have to choose a billing address for the user, and I'm going to proceed to the checkout. This particular instance is integrated with PayPal. So what I'm going to do is to pay in PayPal. So I'm going to choose my PayPal account. I'm going to sign in within PayPal. Okay, we redeem this. Okay, I'm going to buy €5 with my PayPal money. Okay, this is loading. Okay, my payment has been accepted. So you can see that we have webinar data here in active state, which means that I have access to the data. So if we review this, these are the products that we have acquired. I have the webinar data one. I can rate the offer, for example. I can read the information. I can read the characteristics of the service. I can review the agreements, and I can see the list of charge that I have made. I have paid €5 November the 4th. The concept is initial charge of €5, and I can download invoice, this kind of thing. But the important point is that if I go back here and I get an access token for the customer file, I am able to make this request, and now I have access to the data, okay? So now our Streetlight data is offered through an offering and it is monetized. But until this point, what we have been using is an extension that was already there, which is the NGSILD extension, which is supposed to be integrated with KeyCloak and is supposed to be integrated with API Umbrella. So it is expecting a very particular environment because we need to integrate with a security framework. But what if you want to monetize something, maybe a service, maybe data, maybe an application, and you cannot do it because there is not a business API ecosystem available? Do you need to create a marketplace from scratch? No, you don't need to do that. You can create a business API ecosystem extension. Business API ecosystem extensions are intended to manage each of these digital assets and are basically zip files. Our zip files, we have an structure which requires you to have a package.json file in the root of the structure where you have to provide the metadata of the extension. Basically, you have to provide the asset type, which is the name that is displayed in this select that we have seen. We need to provide which are the supported format, whether it's URL or whether it's a file that needs to be uploaded, and in general, the metadata definition. All these form fields that are displayed in the graphical interface are defined in this package.json. And the business API ecosystem and extensions are written in Python. So you need to provide a main plugin class, which is a class inheriting from the plugin class defined by the business API ecosystem. There you can implement different event handlers that are called during the lifecycle of the products and the lifecycle of the offers. And then you can provide any number of Python files that you may need. If you need a library or you need something like that, then you can provide it. But maybe it's easier if we have a quick look on how an extension is looked like. This is the NGSILD query that I have used right now. You can see that the name is the information which is displayed in the select. You have author version, meta information. You have the media types, which in this case we are only supported application LD JSON. This is a list. In case you are supporting just a specific set of media types, you can provide them in the list. And if you support any kind of media type, you can let this list to be empty. And then instead of a select in the form, you are going to have a text input, so the user can write the media type. You can specify the formats. There are two formats supported by the system, which are URL and file. You can provide one, you can provide the other, or you can provide both. So you can create an extension that supports both file and URLs. Then you can provide the pool accounting option that can be true or can be false. This is intended, as we are going to see, for the management of the accounting data that is used in order to support the pay-per-use models. If a pool accounting is false, then it is supposed that you have an external service that is able to manage all that accounting, all that monitoring of the usage of your extension. And you have an external service that is accessing to the usage API of the component. So you are pushing the data into the business API ecosystem. And if you state that the pool accounting is true, it means that this is going to work the other way around. Your extension is going to access your system in order to read the accounting information and save it within the business API ecosystem software. And finally, we have the form field, which basically allows you to provide any kind of metadata you want to provide. A type text is basically a text input. You can use select, checkbox, text area, and so on. The label is what it is displayed. You have the place folder, and you can state whether this metadata is mandatory or not. And then we have this, which is called module. This is a Python import module. So this is the file, in this case, NGSI query, and this is the class, which is NGSI, that is going to implement the plugin. And this is implementing the plugin interface, which is defined by the Business API ecosystem software. This plugin interface is defining the different handlers that you can implement. It is not mandatory to implement any of the handlers except the usage one if you state the pool accounting to true. And you can do whatever you need in your scenario. For example, in this case, we have this handler, which is called on post-product spec validation, which is executed every time you create a product and the product has been validated by the Business API ecosystem. And it is called with a provider, that is the user who has created the product and the asset that has been created. And here you can typically make the validations, a validation that are specific to the asset you are creating. For example, in our case, we are checking, we have a Keyrock client and we are checking that the user is the owner of the application in Keyrock. So if he is authorized to offer this, we are going to check that the role that has been provided as metadata, you can see that all these form fields that appear in the interface becomes a dictionary within the asset object, which is called metainfo. So we can have an access to this role, in this case is webinar.light, and we can check that this role is part of the of this application in Keyrock. And then we can modify, even if we can modify the metainfo if we want of the asset. In this case, I am saving the application ID of the app within the metainfo, which is something that you can do or not. We have other handlers, for example, we have the on post product offering validation, which it is called every time a new offer is created for this particular asset. So you receive the asset and you receive the product offering. So, and it is used in order to validate offering information. In this case, for example, since this is an extension that supports pay-per-use, we are checking that the price unit that has been stated as part of the pricing model is valid for this extension. So this is what we are validating here. And well, this is from the point of view of the validation. Then we have the activation, where we have two handlers, on product acquisition and on product suspension. This is called every time a user acquires your product and it receives the asset, the contract at the order. And in this case, it's simple. We are picking the Keyrock and we are granting in this application to this user the role that we have. And this is what has happened. And the product suspension, which is the other way around. When you cancel your order or when you just didn't pay, we revoke the permissions with the application, the customer, and the role. And finally, we have the usage part. In this case, this has the pool accounting to true. So we have to implement these two methods. The get usage spec is quite simple. you need to return which are the units you are going, your system is able to monitor, and the unit that you can use as part of the price models, which in this case, this system is quite simple. They are only supporting API calls. And this is what it is returned. And then you have to implement the get pending and config method. We receive the asset, the contract and the order, and you need to return the accounting in the last time you save the accounting and the new timestamp for that accounting info. And with all these handlers, you are able to create extensions for this business API ecosystem. Once you have all this stuff, you can create a zip file. And then the business API ecosystem has a couple of commands that you can use in order to install the plugin in the software, to remove the plugin, or to update the plugin. Okay, and to finish, I'm going to show you a couple of useful resources. As I haven't have a deep look into the security part of this stuff, here you have a very interesting webinar in YouTube that you can have a look at, explaining how to secure firewall architectures. And then, the code of the Business API Ecosystem software is available at GitHub in this particular repository. The Business API Ecosystem documentation is available in ReadTheDocs in this link. And also, the API Umbrella software that we have used is also available in GitHub. So that has been all from my side. Thank you so much for attending to this Wednesday webinar, and have a nice rest of the day.